Well, welcome to a new Harry's Garage, and today I haven't just got one car, I've got two cars to show you, the Range Rover Classic. And the reason I've got two in is because this model lasted forever. It initially came out in 1970, press launch was in June 1970, first custom cars around September that year, and then went on right through to 1996. And the two I've got here, I've got one from the very first year of production, and Suffix A as it's known at. That's this one, and then behind me I have a 1993 Vogue, I see, and we'll just see how those two models have changed. But it strikes me that classic cars, they used to just be about, you know, celebrating Ferraris and Lamborghinis and things at the top end. But now the market's changed, and we celebrate the iconic cars, the cars that changed history. And the Range Rover is very definitely one of those. And now you've even got Jag Land Rover introducing a classic department. And you can now buy a reborn Range Rover Classic. It's £135,000 as well. And that sort of thing would never have happened even 10 years ago. So the market is really changing, the spotlight has gone onto this car. Now, it's a model I know quite a lot about, having worked out. I've owned Range Rovers for around 30 years now. The earliest one I've owned is a 1984 one, and I've owned them right through. So I'm really close. I really enjoy the duality, the character of this car. But there's some key areas on this car that make it so important. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take this Suffix A, take it outside and show you around that car in detail. Now, go back to 1970 when this car was first launched. And there wasn't another car on the market with permanent four-wheel drive. That's what made this car so unique. That's a slight white lie, because there was a Jensen Interceptor FF out there, highly specialised car. They sold 300 of them over about 5-6 year period from 1963. But it wasn't anything like this car, that it was this ultimate off-roader, which is this car I was trying to do. Land Rover at the time had their Series 2. And that car was great for farmers, etc. But if you showed it a motorway, it got very tedious indeed. It didn't do motorway speed. So they needed something to update that became this usable car that could do 70 miles an hour on the motorway and could ride beautifully across this sort of ground I've got around here, and was just a car for all seasons. And I've got an original brochure here, which I really quite enjoy, because their buyer for this car, what was he going to be, a surveyor or something? It used to do all sorts of jobs, and towing, it had a tow well. But I love this, that it was sort of part transit, part luxury car, part off-roader. So let's have a look inside. Okay, well, if you know Range Rover today, this is a very different look, this very first Range Rover. Spartan, I think, about sums it up. They wanted it so a farmer could own this and go carry mud into the car and just hose it out at the end of the day. So it's just plastic city here. Everything is plastic. It was known as the Airfix dash. This is really quite poor quality, it feels like now. And then the center console, that's just got a big mat on it. There's not an ounce of carpet in this car anywhere. But the great thing was, you could literally just sweep it out. There's no sills on this car. It all just comes out. Doors open really wide. And then also, it's a two-door, and you had these great big seats with these integrated seat belts. And if you wanted to get in the back, you lift this up and back it goes like that. And also on the door, I've always quite liked it, you've got a handle for the front passenger, and there's another one here for the back passenger, so he can get in and out as well. So very Spartan look in here. I can tell this is a Series 1 just because it hasn't got any carpet anywhere. It's actually got a vinyl roof in it as well, and just a single light in the top. Super basic. If I look at the gear stick, 4-speed, that's all you've got. There's no automatic gearbox on option when this car was new. It took into the 80s to get a 5-speed gearbox. No power steering, very simple dash layout, just speedo. They used to do about just touched 100 miles an hour if you were really lucky and the wind was behind you, etc. But it's the other thing that strikes you when you look at this today is the slimness of the pillars. How a Range Rover was constructed, it had this lattice chassis underneath and coil sprungs onto the axles, and that's where its strength was, all underneath. You then popped on a steel shell behind here with the pillars, and then you bolted on all the body panels. So all this really had to do was just to hold the roof on. There was no real strength from this construction here. You think about the seat belts, they went through the seat and into the chassis as well. And that's why it feels so airy. When we go and drive, you'll notice just how low the windows are. It's just a huge, you know, viewing platform. It's a wonderful place to sit, and it was unique. And I think people recognised that when they first got behind the wheel. Now let's go around the back. Right, around the back, this stayed with Range Rover and is still there today, this two-piece tailgate. The top part, just a metal frame like these. Now these rust like crazy. Remarkably, this looks like it's the original one because it's got the clear glass in it with no heater element. It tells me it's a very early one. And then you had to, on the early ones, you had this handle under here. Sometimes this sticks. Oh, there we go, we're okay. And that's how you open up. That's steel as well, and that rusts like crazy. So it's remarkable, the condition of this car. See, just rubber, you throw your dead sheep and things into the back of this. You've got a lovely sort of toolkit, old early toolkit there, starting handle and the thing to blow your tires in. They do also rot under this thing. You can't really tell, but it's a metal floor under there. And you see also how you just flop that seat down with that handle, and you turn your, you have to flip the backrest up as well. But yeah, you've got this enormous space for carrying things in it. And if you've got, you want to have things carrying out the back of your Range Rover, well then you've got this neat device, which is this number plate, which I just do this. That then swings down. And then from behind, you can, yeah, you can do that, and you can carry things in the back and still have your number plate on display, which keeps PC Plod very happy. Quite unusual, this car, because it hasn't got a tow bar on it. Normally you find with Range Rover, that was a sort of something that everybody seemed to do with their Range Rovers. But it's got that aluminium finished bumper. And if you just go around here, another key feature of this, which I love, this again, it's only on the very first Suffix A's. If I open this up and then pull that out, I have that extension like that, so I can fill it up from a jerry can or something like that. Now you might notice quite a few early Range Rovers have a protector around the lights. And I'm not surprised, because it drives you crazy. If you look at the number of screws British Leyland used to fit this stupid thing here, I think there's 16 or something screws in all. So if you've got a change of bulb or anything, it drives you nuts. Again, on the early Range Rover, another way of telling is you can use a starter handle. If you're feeling very strong, you've got the starter handle in the back of the car and you put it in there and have a go starting your 3.5-litre V8. Yeah, you need strong arms. Metal grille, very distinctive. And on these early ones, you have a different catch in the middle. And there we are. Now that's the heart of the Range Rover, and what stayed with it all through its life was the Rover V8 petrol engine. And this early one's carburettor, you had to again wait until, well, I think it was the late 80s to actually get fuel injection in one of these. But this is a very airy sort of engine compartment on here, because there's no, the later ones have power steering pump sort of here, air conditioning came, etc. This super early one, very bare, lots of room to do things. I love how this car, I don't think it's been restored. I think it's had some paint in its past, but it just has that look that this hasn't actually been restored, this car, which is terrific. And the bit I can tell this is a really early car is because right at the end it has an A in its chassis number. That tells me it's a Suffix A, one of the very first cars. Right, let's go and see what it drives like. Yeah, you can tell from the bangs, there's not a lot of sound deadening or anything in the doors. I'd say aluminium skin on the outside. Yes, an integral non-inertia seatbelt. They're a bit of a pain. But there we go. Handbrake. Yeah, operates on a drum in the middle of the prop shop, and off we go. Now, I've been living with this car for a few days, never actually owned a really early Range Rover like this one. But the bit that strikes me is those great big coil springs and how softly it rides. Quite remarkably. Cars used to have a really amazing ride back then. And if I'd ride up here, there's a ridge here, and I can, because of that long travel suspension, I can go over that ridge that would just destroy most cars because of the axle articulation on this vehicle. It didn't work quite so well on road because that huge amount of axle articulation and long springs actually gave it quite a lot of roll on the road. But out here, in a field, in an off-road environment, it was remarkably successful. I've been fascinated with the Paris-Dakar, and I was looking at the history of the Paris-Dakar. And the first event was held in 1979, finished in 1980, because it used to be over that Christmas New Year break. And guess what won the car class? Yeah, a Range Rover. Won it again in 1981. But it's really in its element in this sort of conditions, on this sort of terrain. The other really distinctive thing on this car is that V8 woofle. Been there right through its life, and I think it's part of its success, because that really told you that you're in something pretty special from the driver's seat. They did do diesel versions, but they built them for economy, and it sort of went against what Range Rover was about, but I suppose it's part of its mass appeal. I can't get it. We're going up a hill here, and yeah, I took the Maserati Levante up here the other day. Yeah, didn't want to know. I'm straight up in here, in this car. It really does know how to work off-road, this thing. Just pointing downhill. I've got no ABS or anything in this day and age. It's 1971, remember? Yeah, it's very good down here. But actually, it was how it was on the road that really made this car change the complexion of the car park and really stamp its authority, what made Range Rover important. So let's go and take it on road now. First thing that strikes you when you get behind the wheel of a Range Rover is how high, how elevated you are. And not only are you in a taller vehicle, for whatever reason, the seat is positioned so you're in the roof. You're looking down. And if I look out out the front, well, I'd say almost, well, about a quarter of my vision is the front bonnet. I've got two wing mirrors right at the outside on this early car. But it is amazing visibility out. And this idea that you can sort of place the car, because you feel completely on top of the car, because you know where all the corners are. I can see those corners, but behind me I can see the back of the car because of that breeze block styling. So although it's a big car, it doesn't feel particularly intimidating because of the incredible visibility. And I suppose if you're the landowner, it sort of gives you the best view on the outside world. I'm sure it's part of its popularity. And again, this being a very early car, I'm having to shout a bit, because the drivetrain on these was a bit noisy. I can't quite tell because the needle's doing this, but it's around 55-60. But there is a distinct whirling going on from underneath here. And that's the transfer gearbox mainly behind here, down here. It comes out of the back of the gearbox off on the engine. And then there's this high-low ratio gearbox, and then a transfer gearbox that sends the power to the back and the front. And that has to drop down, and it's the gears that you can hear. It's gear-driven in this particular version. And there is this constant noise. And as the years went by, you got more and more sound deadening. To try and shut it up. Four-speed manual. I'm desperately looking for a fifth gear, but it's not there. Overdrive sort of arrived in the late 70s that sort of helped. But really, I'm just lolloping along this incredible ride, soft ride, with the most spectacular view of the outside world. And roll, I'm mean, that wasn't much of a corner, but I could feel this distinct bit of rolls went round. It actually gets a lot worse the more people you get in it, because the weight is, the centre of gravity of this car is pretty low down, with that ladder chassis and the gearbox and stuff. That's down there. So one up, it's sort of bearable, but get four people in the car, and you don't have to lollop around the corners, and roundabouts are a bit of a giggle, a bit of a Citroën 2CV sort of giggle, if there's more people in the car. There. That feels a lot more sensible at this sort of speed. A lot more refined. The V8 3.5 at launch, twin carburetors, 135 horsepower, 180 foot-pounds torque. Maximum power's 4,700, I think, actually, RPM. So you're never really revving it, but it sounds quite busy. But there is no doubt that every time you start up, it's the V8. And there was a slight issue at launch, because you're right in the middle of the oil crisis. And this car isn't very good on fuel. I looked at an old autocar, actually it was motor report on it, no power steering as well, and you keep to it in the wheel. Yes, and they average on their test 14 miles to the gallon, which I think is about right. You might get 15, but you're 14, 15 miles to the gallon in this car. So while there's an oil crisis on and the fuel is getting potentially rationed, it's quite a brave choice back in the 70s to choose a Range Rover, but people certainly did. And it proved so popular that the export to America never actually happened to begin with. In the first few years, home demand and European demand was so high, they just couldn't make them build them fast enough, and they had to forget about taking this car to America. Well, not until the 80s actually. I think it was 87 it finally officially launched in America. But on roads like this, I just love it. The way I'm sort of looking over the heads, I've got this great visibility. It's just ace, and it burbles along with a ride like no other. It's utterly suited to these sort of roads. There was no other driving experience like this in its day. There is you just take this out in all weathers, and it just gives you a sense of confidence. Whatever you put in front of it, you're going to get there. There's nothing it can't tackle. It's a sort of general feeling from behind the wheel. And it's part of the reason they all, there aren't that many left now, because of course you used it in all the snow and the grot and the ice. And what else are you going to take? You've got a Range Rover in the garage. Well, that's the car you're going to use. And that, unfortunately, is why a lot of them rusted away. The other thing, it just might have felt that, is the shunt. The gear, all the drivetrain, as you come off, on and off the throttle, you hear all those clunks and bangs and all the drive shafts sort of going, and then they get going again. So, there we go. It does encourage you, because of it, to drive in a very smooth manner, because you know it's there. And you sort of get used to it. You just take it out, you're just more delicate on the clutch and on the accelerator and coming off the accelerator, and you can just sort of disguise it. Very pretty time. Well, I think what we need to do now is swap over to the later one, the 93 version of the Range Rover. And then you'll get a chance to see just how much improved over the years. It's a bit different. First of all, seat belts are on the pillar. I've got armrests, and everything instantly feels more comfortable. And off we go. Yeah, this feels dramatically better. The other one sort of feels like a development special. Right at the start of its sort of journey. And there's a lot of years of development. Good Lord, feel how quiet it is, that drivetrain. Now, a number of things have changed with this car. First of all, the V8 has grown from 3.5 to 3.9 litres. It's gained fuel injection. So it's 185 horsepower against 135 and 235 foot-pounds of torque, so 50 foot-pounds of extra torque as well. Much more firepower up the front. And then the drivetrain is very different too. Four-speed automatic. About 1982 that eventually arrived, as did the four-door. It's been a four-door car. But the big change was the transfer gearbox. Instead of being mashing gears and all that noise we had on this car, it's chain. And with chain drive, the noise sort of disappeared. And it's so noticeable as soon as I get into this car from the Suffix A. It just feels so much more refined. And why did this happen? Well, it's because the buyers of the car, they've changed. To begin with, it was the landowner, City Gent, and towing things. And then it sort of became more increasingly fashionable, and also because the car was so damn good, to bring that sort of country life into the city. And this became the car for the directors, for the cinema. This said, this was a sort of statement car. You had a connection with the country and you worked in the city. And you just saw London fill up with Range Rovers. It's bizarre, but it's that visibility bit again. You can park it within a sort of tiniest of gaps. And it just became the car to do everything. And the numbers just grew. And I can't tell you the difference between this and the Suffix A. It feels quite grunty, away from the, just away from standstill, and just there's that lusty V8 sound. There's no effort. I'm already doing 60 down this little lane. And the suspension just has that much more degree of control about it. This is a 93 car. It's still actually on springs, but just after, well, it was an option around this period. You've got air suspension. And you could lower it for easy access and then it go up to normal height or go for extra ground clearance. It's slightly problematic. I had it on my car and it had its moments of bags going pop and pumps not working, and you find your car either glued to the ground or right up in the air. But this is coil sprung, this particular one. But it's gained anti-roll bars front and rear. Boy, does it make a difference. It still rolls, but nothing like before. It really is, you can hardly compare the two cars. There's that much improvement over the years. I have to say, this is 93 and the other one was 71. So what's that, 22 years of development. It really feels it from behind the wheel. So what else has changed in here compared to the Suffix A? Well, I've got a much bigger dash. I've got a taco dancing around. I recognise that from the binnacle. Unfortunately, obviously, this was British Leyland era, and it shares some componentry with a Maestro. The good news now is no one actually knows what an Austrian Maestro is, but it's a bit of a downside because it wasn't the greatest of cars. It's a bit of a shame that it's got this layout. The final one actually went to something known as the soft dash. It's the one I've actually got, which I might restore, which got the dash out of a Discovery 2. So it actually has airbags and much neater ventilation and various things. But this particular car is a Vogue. Leather upholstery was an option. I've got this velour trim. It's really quite cosy when you get into it. It's quite nice to live with. Bits of wood have arrived in the cabin. The same sort of visibility as in the Suffix A, so this dramatically low glass area here, almost poke my knee above the glass. That's what makes a Range Rover, so the same visibility out the front. The back, the tailgate arrangement's still the same, but it's all now padded. It's got a parcel shelf in it to hide things underneath, and spare wheel in the back of there. Oh, I've got air conditioning now as well. So you recognise a car with air conditioning, a Range Rover, because it has these extra vents all the way along the fascia here. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 outlets of air conditioning and a stereo radio cassette player in the middle. Suffix A, if you wanted a radio, that was optional, and you've got one speaker which is in the middle. Now that I have speakers everywhere, they put a funny little tray here, and I find it quite amusing that the tray is the perfect size for an iPhone 7. Who knew that was made for an iPhone? Land Rover knew in 1990 that's what that was going to be used for. So yeah, a dramatically different car, and dramatically improved. Can't get over the feeling of grunts in this car, the 3.9 litre V8. It is a dramatic change to what went before. It just 0 to 30 feels spectacular on it. Very odd. I mean, it's still like the Suffix A, it still likes a drink. Yeah, I've done 130 miles so far on this tank, and it's just sort of coming down towards the quarter full. So yeah, it's better than the 14 to the gallon. Like, it's probably about 15, 16 to the gallon. So yeah, you do not buy a Range Rover for economy. You just buy it for the way it feels, the relaxing ride, and this sort of effortlessness about it. That's actually something I found when I have used this off-road. What I love about this particular model, they used to have this, you had to lock up the central diff. It's already getting a bit technical, but this one has a viscous diff down there. So it doesn't matter, you don't touch a thing. But you can have low and high range, you could alter that, I suppose. But if you're driving this vehicle off-road, well, all you do is just point and steer. There are no terrain response buttons, no locking diffs, no nothing. It will just go through. If it's going to get through, it will get through. And I sort of love that about Range Rover, because that's part of it. It's fully automatic, everything's auto. You can do anything, and it can go up muddy slopes, and it can go across snow, and it can go across sand, and it can go down Sloan Square. It does everything. You don't have to fiddle around with a different mode. It's that, to me, is sort of pure luxury. That's the ultimate. The refinement is shocking between the two models, I have to say. Here we are, we're up at the legal limit. I don't feel I have to shout anymore. The drivetrain is almost silent. There's a little bit of rustling from the mirrors, which have not handily moved the door. There's no quarter lights now on this this model. It is very refined. There was a big change between 3.5 and 3.9 litre when they made that change, more than the horsepower would suggest. They did have injected 3.5, 165 horsepower, 185 with the 3.9, but it's that bottom end grunt and that immediate acceleration is what you notice. And the four-speed auto is quite reactionary as well. Locks up in top. So I'm doing, well, just over 2000 RPM. But yeah, it's this relaxation behind the wheel, just that this sort of cruise, this flip down armrest, and the perfectly on the door, perfectly where I put my right elbow, and I just sit here and you just cruise and just watch the world go by from these panoramic windows. That's what Range Rover is about, and what it continues today, but it's especially so in this Classic. A very relaxing car. You can see how it sort of took on, and what it works in the city, it works in the country, it works on motorways. The Suffix A, that really works off-road, really works around your estate, and sort of works going into your market town at weekends. That was sort of what Suffix A to me. Oh, we could also go around the jungle and win at Dakar. But this one has this extra refinement about it. That's how it became a jack of all trades. It was carting family, it was going to business meetings, pulling up at the Potter's Hotel, pulling up at the chute, pulling up at the gamekeeper. It did everything. That's why it took off, that's how it got established, and it's why it's still an iconic car today. So there you go, I hope that's given you a bit of insight into Range Rover Classic. If you enjoyed the video, keep watching, keep subscribing, more videos coming along very soon.